So yesterday there was this question about mass hosting web service, I guess, and there were some requirements. First of all, the integrity requirement, basically containing user processes. And the second requirement was compartmentalizing user processes. And the third requirement was availability, making sure that users would not be able to bring the server to its knees. And so the question was whether SELinux would be able to help in some of these aspects. So let's just have a look at that. Let's see if I can demonstrate some of this. I need to install a system. SELinux 6.4. URL options, like a minimum install, no base, and texts. And I'll just make this 2048. With two CPUs, or yeah, two threads. And then I'll select the disk dev SDL2, customize before install, and then just enable ACPI. Select the CPU and set QXL as the default video, and just install. So basically, the idea is to use the SELinux type enforcement security model for integrity, the multi-category security model for compartmentalization, and use Linux control groups for availability. Now, I do already foresee some issues. Let's just see how we can deal with that and see if things actually work the way I expect them to work. But basically the issue was that previously this person did mass web hosting using stuff like rsync or SCP or SFTP, but the current requirement was that users get a shell on the system. By giving a user a shell on the system, you basically get yourself in a whole new world of hurt, I guess. So I'm just setting up a minimal system. Really as little packages as possible, like 200, 230, I guess, something like that. And then just focus on some of the core aspects. So I'm just focusing on the three requirements that I just mentioned. I'm not going to into all the other security aspects of hosting local users. There's much more you need to do to make it to make yourself confident about hosting local users. But I'm just going to focus on the three aspects. So the users are basically expected to log in via SSH, and then in their home directory there's a virtual host set up, so they can basically upload some file there in the web root in their home directory, and that stuff will be hosted by the web server. And yeah, I guess that's pretty much it. But basically there are so many options, so it's basically up to you. For example, you could use SSH cgroup, which basically has some advantages but also some disadvantages. The advantage is that you can use SSH to restrict users to their home directory. To cgroup them into their home directory. But that's basically, then you depend on SSH for a large part to do that. The drawback is, or the disadvantage is, that you'll need to give that user extra permissions from a SELinux perspective, so that he can actually cgroup. So that user probably needs the cgroup permission, I guess, or maybe even set UID. I think he even needs set UID permissions. So you need to basically allow those for that functionality. So you should basically decide whether that's worth it or not. And there's a lot of other things to consider. We'll just have a look and see. So 211 packages for a minimum, no base install. It'll be done soon. First thing I will do is just create, a user or two users, and see if we can get MCS to work. Because I suspect that Red Hat made some modifications to MCS, and that might make MCS not work by default. You need some small modifications to get that to work, if it works at all in the way I think it should work. That's the question. We'll see about that. doing some post installation, I guess. So basically, I chose Red Hat 6.4, CentOS 6.4 for this, and reboot. I'll just update the system. Probably a good idea, and install some packages. So root, the password, and IP address show. It's not inst- oh, it is actually installed. So I have an IP address of 247. Update. Let's update 4 first. In the meanwhile, SSH root at 192.168.1.22. Fucking out of. I forgot the IP address already. Slow connectivity. Strange. Maybe it's just taking a mirror. Yeah, it's just slow. Actually, something doesn't look too right. Oh, probably, not sure, but that's probably due to Firt IO. Not sure. We'll see. Speeds are terribly slow. I'm connected to. this web. It's still slow. Maybe it's just my connection. This web should be pretty fast. So I wonder why that is. I wonder why it's slow. Oh, it's installing. No, it's still downloading. So yeah, that this is taking a little while. I guess I just picked an unfortunate mirror. It happens. Basically, it's routing all this data to 1.2.2 network. It's receiving it and sending it. Not that that should be a problem to my network interface, but maybe the third IO is a bit buggy or. So yeah, first thing you probably want to do, or what I would want to do, is set up NTPD, so that we have some assurance that the time on the system is correct. And in my case, probably also want to install ACP ID, so that I can basically everything is all right. Basically, you can send stop signals to the guest so that I can basically reboot it from outside of the guest. And then I guess a web server, although that can wait, I guess. Oh yeah, and I probably want to install a text editor right away, because I use Nano for simple system administration stuff. So yeah, let's just do that. Before I reboot. So yeah, the network is now idle again. So it was actually, I guess I caught a bad mirror. Or maybe my internet connection is shitty. Because my provider is an amateur. Yum, install NTP nano and need NTP nano and ACPI. Oh, and not ICPI, it's a little bit early. ACPID. So I'll just check config. I guess this is the old way. Check config, enable entropy. Entropy on. Yeah, it's I'm a bit confusing with systemd. And it's entropyd on also. And ACPID on. ACPID on. And that's not there either. And then basically, I don't need to start it right now because I'm rebooting anyways. So yeah, I guess shut down, reboot. Actually, I'll just do one more IP address show. Because I forgot the IP address. It's 247, shut down, reboot, no. Shut down, 247. It's probably get the same IP address when I reboot. Let's see if everything is green. It's determining its IP address. And that was fast. So let's just see if I can log in with SSH. And it seems, yeah, slow for some reason. Even my local connection is slow. So let's have a look at the PS out. Let's see if we have NTPD up. Yeah, we have NTPD running. Do we have ACPID? Yep, ACPID runs in APMD. NTP QP. Yep, we're pulling. Alright, so this is basically some default system without Apache setup and stuff like that. So basically, and thus I need more to install more. Yum install policy core utils. And you probably can deinstall this after when you're done, although it's not such a big deal. Utils Python, but it does pull in some dependencies. That's probably what I need. See, it does pull in some dependencies, but these are tools that you'll probably want. And the same goes for another tool that I'm about to install. And libcgroup, you need that anyway for availability, setup availability. I'm not going too deep into cgroup configuration because I'm not that good in there with that as well. But I should be able to give you some idea. This takes long. Most SELinux related stuff take quite a bit in Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6. So yeah, yum install SE tools console, which is basically for querying stuff. So basically have a look at SE manage users. Basically there's two security models that we need to take into account. Multi-category security model and type enforcement security model. And there's of course also two other default security models, identity-based access control and role-based access control. But basically you have some predefined SELinux user identities here, and we're going to see where the guest underscore you SELinux identity gets us with regard to integrity on the system. Basically, this is a predefined SELinux user identity that restricts SSH login users, but it does so in a one size fits all way. So although it's pretty restricted for SSH login users, it's not as restricted as one could restrict SSH login users if one had a clear vision of what a user should do. So, but we're going to basically use the guest underscore you SELinux user identity, and then I'm going to try is to basically assign categories. So we have like 10-24 categories, assigned categories or sets of categories to basically compartmentalize users. So the as the info tool can give you some info about some types or other security identifiers. So XD, guest, D. let's see. Yeah. So that's cool. Oh, actually, that's not cool. Basically, you have some type security type. Attribute security identifiers, which are basically ways to group type security identifiers. Basically these strings classify the type for use for type enforcement to basically enforce integrity on this user. So I was looking for a attribute called mcsuntrustedproc or mcsconstraintType to be associated to guest T, so that guest T would be mcsconstraint. But I guess that's not the case, and I already expected that. So let's just have a look at SE info, and then X attribute, and then let's see if I can mcs and trusted proc, I guess. Not a valid attribute name, so let's just see what it is. SE info A, and then grep MCS. Yeah, oh, it's this one is it. So this one should be assigned to a guest, actually, to make guest MCS constraint. So I guess that's one thing we need to basically do first. So what's our current working directory? Is root. So we just need to hack the policy up right away. So make dir my MCS, I guess I call that, or actually my guest, because it's going to be a modification to the guest policy module. CD my guest, nano my guest te, and then policy module, which is a policy module declaration, call that my guest. It is the policy module name, and the version is 1.0.0. and then basically we're going to I'll see if we can make this optional, probably not optional, policy. And then we need to import some stuff, gen require, and then the attribute MCS untrusted proc, type guest T. I guess that's probably, I can't make this optional, I'm not sure. Anyway, so we're going to assign this MCS untrusted proc type attribute security identifier to the guest underscore T type security attribute. So type attribute guest T MCS untrusted proc. And that should probably be it. Make F to build this if it's installed. User shares Linux devel make file my guess pp, and it's actually installed. And then and then install it as in my do command my guess. And that all, if all goes well, modifies the xguest underscore t type security identifier. We'll check that out and see if the mcsuntrustedproc list proc type attribute security identifier will be added to this list. So we'll just copy this over, then see if we have that one. Yeah. So now the mcsuntrustedproc is basically assigned or associated to guest T. So that will make it so that we can basically enforce MCS on guest users. So next thing we need to do is we need to change the guest as Linux user identity. So when we look at user list, we saw some basically mappings or associations. So basically you create the identity based access control model is used by SELinux to basically associate SELinux to traditional Linux security, so to user IDs. And the way that works is basically you'll use these user map, these user associations to create associations between or you create a SELinux user identity and associate that to some SELinux security models, and in this case role-based access control and MCS, and then you basically assign some security identifiers that are used for these security models to the identity, and then later you can use that identity to create the association between SELinux and traditional Linux security. But basically what you see here is so that the guest underscore R role for role-based access control is associated to the guest underscore U as an user identity. So that's fine because we're going to only need that role, I guess, for our guest users. But currently there's no there's no categories associated to this user identity, and since we want to use categories to compartmentalize guest users, we need to basically change that mapping to include the full MCS range, so that we can use that range to assign categories to individual user IDs later. So as we manage user modify, and then it the default level is S0, range is S0C0C1023. Yeah, my system is a little bit laggy now. Basically we keep the roles the same, only guess our role, and then the prefix is user, which the prefixes aren't used anymore, so it's all user, and then basically guest you. That should probably be it. And this will take a little while. It's probably going to build policy again. But that'll give us access to the full MCS range. And now if we'll look, then we'll see that guess you has access to the full MCS range. See, this has changed as opposed to in the previous one. Now we have full access to the MCS range. And we can use that for these mappings as you manage. Manage login lists. Well, sorry for the typos. And these mappings here, and there's only a few do actually do the mapping of SELinux to Linux user IDs or group IDs. So these, the first column are represents the user IDs, and there, of course, you say, okay, default, I don't understand that user ID in system view, I don't understand that user ID, and that's true, because that's some caveats. But you do know the root user ID, which is, I guess, one. Or, I guess, yeah, isn't it actually zero? Anyways, so basically, let's just add a user now. And basically, map that user to the guest underscore u as a Linux user identity. And then just see if we can basically associate a category to that user. So let's just user add Joe. Password. Password. Joe. And that's done. And now basically use the SELinux command to basically associate Joe to the guest underscore u as a Linux user. And then at the in the same run, associate, see if you can associate a default category for Joe. SELinux login a as guest u. Sorry, guess you, and then see if we can do the level as 0 C1 and then Joe. Not sure this, I don't do this every day, so not sure if this is going to work. No, it's just a range, so you just need to. That actually seems to work. So let's see if that list, login list. So now we have Joe associated to guest underscore u as a Linux user. So it's a guest user, and we have a MCS range of one category, C1. Let's just see if we can get this stuff to actually log in. So SSH Joe at, forgot the IP address again. IP address Joe. So yeah, now Joe is logged in with category 1. So, and then, and in the guest T domain. So guest T is pretty much, pretty confined. But let's just add a new user. Now in theory, if you add a new user with the same as a Linux user identity, then it'll get the same first three fields in the security context. So from a integrity perspective, it will have the same security attributes than Joe does, if Jane, for example, would be mapped to a guest as well. So then basically, from that perspective, Jane would be able to see Joe, and Joe should be able to see Jane. But the MCS compartmentalization basically adds an additional layer for compartmentalization. So that should, in theory, make it so that Joe cannot see Jane and Jane cannot see Joe. But that's theory, so let's just have a look at if that works. So let's do the same. User add Jane. Password Jane. And then just do that user mapping again, but then just a little bit different. C2 for Jane. And then SSH Jane at and see now Jane doesn't see that Joe's logged into the system, and that's not so much because of type enforcement or not so much because of these attributes. It's because Jane is assigned to category 2 where Joe is assigned to category 1. So this is compartmentalization. They don't see each other, and they also can be made to not see each other's content. So I could, for example, make it so let's just have a look at the home directories. So now both Joe and Jane's home directory are labeled with this security context, and they're both labeled with the S0 sensitivity, which is basically means that there's no categories assigned. So, but in theory, we could basically do cgcon recurse range, I guess. And then S0 C1 for Joe. Joe, not ho. Invalid. Arguments. Role. It's not a role. This is it. And then for Jane, S2. But there are better solutions for this. Better solutions. There are other solutions for this. And we don't actually have to do this, but it's probably nice. So now, for example, if Jane lists home, if Jane is actually allowed that, but Jane is, and Joe is, guest is actually allowed to list home. Actually, that doesn't work the way I expected it to work, because Jane is actually seeing Joe's directory for some reason. So unfortunately, that doesn't work the way I would like it to work. There are workarounds, actually. There are nice workarounds. You could make it that these users can't even list the home directory. They can traverse it, but not list it. You could do that, but that takes much modifications. But anyways, this doesn't work the way I expect it to work, and there's probably just no rule currently that basically constrains users for reading directories, I guess. I could probably look it up. If you look at, for example, here the MCS file, this is my IDE. Here you can find some MCS constraints, but I'm not sure if these constraints are exactly the same. So if you look here, then you have a rule that says constrain the directory and the search permission, the read permission, the IO control and lock permission for directories. If the high level of the target dominates the high level of the the high level of the source dominates the high level of the target, or the type of the source has associated the MCS read all, security attribute, don't constrain it if constraint. That's so that's kind of weird. But I think it's about get attribute, and get attribute is not in this list. Basically to get, but that's weird. And let's see how it's done with files. And files is also no get attribute. So that is weird. Okay, let's add another user with a same category as Joe, just to for shits and giggles to see whether my theory is based on proper facts. And then map John to category one, just the same as Joe. And then just log out Jane, because we're currently looking at Joe. Jane. Let's log in as John. So John is also at category one. See, now John can actually see Joe. So and previously Jane wasn't able to see Joe. So here's what I mean with the compartmentalization or using categories. So if you just use type enforcement, then there wouldn't be no compartmentalization. But now that we use MCS for compartmentalization, we can basically make it so that Joe doesn't see Jane and Jane doesn't see Joe, but since John has the same compartment as Joe, they can see each other. But these constraints, so they do apply for processes, but somehow they don't apply to listing your home directory, because the categories are assigned to the home directories, but John can still see Jane's home directories even though he doesn't have that access. So the constraints do not apply to that, but I guess you could even make that you could make it change that. But anyways, let's just do it anyways. But if you need to be careful that if you do this, this uses tcon command to manually change the categories of the home directories, that if you do restore con rv home, that everything will be reset. See, everything will be reset. Oh, and actually it's not. That's weird. But that's cool. So it doesn't reset the categories. That's nice. But the categories don't do much good anyways. But anyways, so basically let's log out John, because John, we're done with John. John was just to see that type enforcement only doesn't do the compartmentalization. Let's go back to Jane. So now basically, Jane's home directory, everything is category C2. So if I touch test and lsalt test, then you can see that test is created with the category 2 in the user home directory only. and don't get confused by the bash files with the identity identifier of unconfined view. That's basically for the identity identifier is a security attribute that is used to associate SELinux to traditional Linux security. And optionally, it can be used to basically do isolation, do compartmentalization on the identity field, on the identity security attribute, as opposed to the category attribute with multi-category security. But that functionality of compartmentalization based on identities is not enabled in Red Hat. So it's not a problem if you see files with unconfined underscore u, because there are no constraints related to that. We're not using that security model. So that's no problem. We're dealing with the category for compartmentalization, the type for integrity, and then role-based access control a little bit, and identity-based access control a little bit, but not much. It's not very, we only have one role associated to our user, so that's a pretty simple setup. And the identity is only used to map SELinux to traditional Linux security, so it's not used to constrain processes. Now anyways, we set this shit up, RM test. So we already have some level of integrity, and we have some level of compartmentalization. So now basically, as for HTTP, and I'm not a HTTP admin big shot, so yum install HTTP. But let's see if I can get something to work. So if to set up HTTP, you probably need to, I'll just use the ugly way, etc sysconfig and IP tables, I guess. And just add port 80. This is not the recommended way to do this. You should use the IP tables command. But and then how do you service command. Yeah, I'm used to systemd by now. Servers reload IP tables. I think reload should probably do that. Oh, and it's the other way around. Systemd change the change that. So in systemd, you first do the action and then do the name of the service. And with service, you do the name of the service first and then the action. Anyway, see if that was committed. And it doesn't seem to be, so I guess I need to actually restart it. And now it's committed. So let's see if I can actually access that website. And able to connect, because HTTPD isn't even running. Check config, and then it's HTTPD enable, I guess. And if it's not, then it's the other way around. Oh, and it's on. All right, and then service. HTTP start. I could not determine a reliable host name. Yeah, I know about that stuff. Oops. And it's up. So, where's my shell? For Christ's sakes. So, nano etc HTTPD conf. I'll just do some simple stuff. And then there's some user dir usedir enabled, and I'll use the default of public HTML and for all users. Just, you should do this better. Well, I'm just trying to get this shit going. Now, oops. Let's restart that again. Failed. Enable. Jesus Christ. Nothing is Betsy user there. Nothing is intuitive. Enabled. So you need to actually specify users if you enable it. Now that's good. That's not the problem. It's good. And I need to, don't you use the capital. Enabled. Joe, Jane, but it's just not intuitive. But it this does work. So now for Joe, so Joe is a guest user. It's confined, but Joe does have some permissions because I already told you that the guest key is basically compromised. It is restricted, pretty much, but on the other hand, it's also has some permissions to make some default functionality work. So since we know that guest is used for web hosting, guest can do some stuff. But guest, and from an SELinux perspective, guest can do some stuff. That means that you need to educate your users or inform your users, because the users have some discretion when it comes to SELinux. So the discretion that they have, they need to be aware of that. So what is that? Well, SELinux, and you don't have to explain all the details to your users, just the functionality details. But SELinux targets, by default, the policy in Red Hat Enterprise Linux, targets specific processes. And by default, it doesn't target users. We actually manually change it to also target our Joe and Jane and John users, but by default it doesn't target users. But by default it aims to target system services like HTTPD. And you can see that if you basically do a ps out, and you can see that HTTPD has a HTTPD underscore T type security identifier, which basically means it's own SELinux environment. And here you have Joe and Jane, which basically have the same type but different categories. But anyways, Apache is targeted. So Apache is constrained, it has some restrictions. So one restriction is that Apache by default cannot access user home content. So content that is generic content, that is content created by users. Now since we want the user to create his website in his home directory, and we want HTTPD to basically be able to serve that, we need to find some way to do that. And the way to do that is we created a bunch of types, and we can list those as the info T, and then grab user, and then also grab HTTPD. We created a bunch of types that users can use to classify content in their home directory as user web server content time. So users have the discretion to label content, to change the security attributes of content in their home directory to these type security identifiers. And thereby, they can basically say, okay, HTTPD can use this as an HT access file, HTTPD can use this as a CGI script executable file, HTTPD can use this as a log file, HTTPD can use this as a upload dir, for example, so that it can read and write to it. This is a process type, so this you should ignore this. This is not a type for files, but for the CGI script process. And this is the type that HTTP can read for example, static content for simple HTML websites. So the user has the discretion to use the cgconfig command to change the type identifier so that he can determine how HTTPD can access that content. So if you want to do it right, then you should basically inform your users of these types and tell them what the functionality of this type is and what it means to label something with these types, so that the user can make an educated decision. Okay, HTTPD needs to write to this directory, so I need to label it with that type. HTTPD need to execute this CGI, so I need to label that CGI with this type. So that's something that you need to educate your users on. So you could make a banner and basically explain those types and explain how the user can basically change stuff. Now basically, so we, by default, we host a, or we instructed HTTPD to host the public underscore HTML directory in the user home directory. So for example, Joe could create, make their public HTML and then cd public HTML and then nano index HTML, and that's basically HTML sticky keys, and then for example a header one, hello world, header one close. So that basically set. Now if you look at that content, then you see the type is still set to user home t, and that's basically the type for generic user home content. So Apache should not read that content, because the user might also have a file in the in its home directory or in this directory by mistake, which has his passwords or his credit card information for that matter, or I don't know what stuff, but stuff that HTTPD should not be able to read. So I explained the types that HTTPD should be able to operate on. Now, this content should be read by HTTPD because it's just a static website. Now, by default, there is a specification in the system that says, okay, label the tilde slash public underscore HTML directory and everything in there with type HTTPD underscore user underscore content underscore t, which is the type that HTTPD can read, the type for static content. So if I run restoreCon as that user, which I can, then since that user has access to relabel from the generic user home content type user underscore t and relabel to the HTTPD user content t type, this should work. So I could basically do this public HTML, and it will reset. Oh, and it's not verbose, so I didn't do it verbose. I should have done verbose, but it did reset to the HTTPD, because SELinux knows that the public underscore HTML dir and everything below there should be labeled with that type. But if I create a CGI script, and I'm not sure if that, but you could look that up, by the way. Let's just, actually, you can't look it up. That sucks. You can actually look it up, but it's ugly. But I'll show you anyways. So by default, there's a list of file context specifications, fcontext. Basically, it's a large list with path, security context combinations that basically instruct SELinux, okay, this path should be labeled that, and that's just basically for failover, just in case you need to restore or reset the security labels. Then SELinux looks at this list and says, okay, this is what this content should be labeled, so I'll just label it accordingly. But the user home directories are treated differently. So they are not in the context specifications are not in this list, but instead they are in cd etc SELinux targeted context files. And here you have a file context file with the period home suffix. You can basically less that, and this is where the context for home directories are, and you can't edit this, and you can't add home dir context specifications manually. You need to use a policy module to do that. I'm not going to go into that here, but if you want to know, just contact me and I'll explain how that works. But anyway, so there should be some context for a public HTML, so let's look that up. We have a public git. But where's my public HTML spec? Am I overlooking it? Well, here for John. Oh, shift. Here it is. And it's a pretty simple spec. It just says, okay, everything in the home directory, for every user home directory, if it's a directory created or a file, actually anything created with www web public HTML. And everything below that, or if it's a file or a dir, then label that HTTP user content D. So it's not, there's no other specification with regard to that, but you could also below have there a CGI bin and then just specify that the CGI bin should be HTTP user script exact D, or that the logs directory should have HTTP user RAT for read and append. Oh. Only and stuff like that, so that the system knows how to label that stuff. But there's another but and if. These types that I showed you with SELinux of SEinfo, these types are also special types in the sense that they are what's called customizable types. And the customizable types are also specified in one level above. Customizable types are also specified in the file here, so we can list that file. And if all is well, then these types are also in there. Yeah, they are. And these types, types that are specified customizable types, are basically types that the restore command by default will not reset, unless you run restore.conf with the force option parameter. That's basically because users have discretion over these types. They can basically use the tcon command to basically change generic user home content to a web server content of any of these classifications. So for example, if a user decides to create a directory blah 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 and decides, okay, I need to classify that HTTP content, and he uses the command to classify it HTTP user content T, then that's not specified in the global list of file context specifications, and then if the administrator needs to restore restore the system, the context, or reset it, then it would basically reset that to the generic user home content type, and Apache would no longer be able to read it, and shit hits the fan, you'll get all kinds of service calls, and you'll be busy all afternoon fixing shit. But so, since this type is a customizable type, RestoreCon will not reset that, so it won't. It says, okay, this content has this type, which is a customizable type, but it's not, the location is not in the list of file context specifications, so it should be another type, but it's a customizable type, so I'm now going to reset it, because RestoreCon is not run with the F force command. So that's just one thing, so the user could just basically create a directory, blah 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 blah, and check on it, user of HTTPD, user content, and then by default RestoreCon will not reset. I can show you that. For example, cd, and I'll just make there blah blah blah, and then I'll just list ldz blah blah blah, and it's by default user home t, and a restore con it, restore con v or rv, so verbose and recurse, blah blah blah, and it all, oh sorry, and it's still user home t type with category 1. Now if I use chicon and I say chicon t, or I actually also recurse and chicon t httpd user content t blah blah blah, then it changed. But this is not specified system wide, so there's no file context specification that says blah 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 should have that type. So in theory, if I use RestoreCon, it should reset it to user home t. But since user HTTPD user content t is a customizable type, that won't work. That won't happen. So if I do RestoreCon v, blah blah blah, it doesn't reset it. Oh, it doesn't reset it. But if I use RestoreCon with the force command, then it will reset it. And it would be interesting to see if it also resets the compartment part. And it actually also resets the compartment part. So now, and it's verbose, so you can see what happens. So now basically this context is reset to the generic user home content type, but also the category is reset to the default category. So be careful with the force flag, because it's going to really reset to what's specified system-wide. And there's another solution for this, but I'm not going to explain it here, but there's a concept of namespacing, and there's a PAM module called PAM namespace, and you can use that basically to create home directories for each category that a user logs in. So if a user would have access to two categories and would specify that, would be able to specify that on the command line. For example, now I'm Joe, and now I'm going to log in category 1. Then he has a different home directory than if he would log in with category 2. And that's used for multi-level security, but you can also use it for multi-category security. But if you do that, then you'll need to add permissions to some of the related services, and that's not something you want. But anyway, so I'll just remove the blah 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 there, RMRF, blah blah blah. So that's something you need to basically instruct your users about, and just something you should know. So now we have this public HTML directory. And we have a static site in there, but you'll see that HTTPD still won't be able to host it. And that's for a couple reasons. one of the reasons is that, oh, and I'll just go to my root shell again, is that HTTP cannot traverse the user home directories. Now, an easy way to do that is to basically gmod plus x all, but a better way would probably be to use access control lists, I guess, to only allow an Apache. But for the sake of simplicity, I'm just going to do the stupid way. I guess I could actually let's just try that. Chown, Jane, Betsy. I'm not sure if this is proper, but it's basically home. Jane. Joe. Not sure if this is a good way to do that, but. And John. And then gmod g plus x home Joe John Jane. So in theory this might take care of the fact that from a traditional Linux perspective, Apache needs to be able to traverse the user home directories to get to the public HTML dir. So that's taken care of in a very ugly way. You should probably use access control lists for that instead of changing the group. But anyways, so from a traditional Linux security perspective, it should work, but it doesn't work yet. It shouldn't work yet from a, as a Linux perspective. So if I go to, and we're hanging again. Forbidden. So you don't have permission to access. Let's see. Less far log access log. And it's HTTPD. We have no access log entry there, error log. And here you have some stuff. So here we have a permission denied, access to Joe denied. Now, if I'm correct, then this is SELinux. So there are, SELinux knows some concept which is called a conditional policy. So that's policy that is conditional. And there's another concept called Booleans, where this basically is conditional policy that uses the state of a Boolean to determine whether some policy should be enabled or disabled. Now, HTTPD, get a cbool, lists all the booleans that you can toggle, but get a cbool grep HTTPD will list all of them related to HTTPD. Now there's a few booleans with regards to this that that you should know. So you have here the HTTPD enable home gears, which is set to off. And there is another one, HTTP reducer content is also set to off. Now this one you want to keep off, preferably, because this will allow HTTPD to read generic user content, so the user underscore home underscore t type content. You don't want that. But you want to set this one here, the HTTPD enable home dirs. That basically allows HTTPD to traverse user home dirs to get to the public underscore HTML directory in this regard, and then it can read the public underscore HTML directory and its content in there, because that has the HTTPD types. So you want to set that, and you want to do that persistent with the capital P, set as ebool capital P, and then that boolean, and you'll set it to on, and that'll take a while because it's going to recompile the policy with those rules inserted that allow Apache to traverse user home directories to get to the web content inside the user home directories. But in theory, that should take care of the denial. So now it should work, but it doesn't work. So let's have a look. Our search mcsuntrustedproc recent to list recent ABC denials. And this added to why that. And we have a policy constraint violation. Ouch. That sucks. Now, what the issue here is that HTTPD runs without a compartment. But the content is labeled with compartment C1. Now, I would have expected HTTPD to not be MCS constrained. So let's have a look. SE info XT HTTPDT. What kind of constraints it has? And it doesn't have any. Constraints related to MCS, and that's weird. This is weird. Because I thought that that stuff needed to be explicitly MCS constrained to constrain it. So if it not explicitly had assigned the MCS untrusted proc type attribute security identifier, then it wouldn't be MCS constrained. But obviously that's not happening here. So there are a couple solutions for this. Either you can just basically override that by assigning a type attribute to HTTPD T, or you could basically give HTTPD full access to the MCS range. And I guess the latter might be the best option. But the MCS read all, using the MCS read all is the easiest option. So I'll just use MCS read all, I guess, to do that. So we need to add another policy module. So cd. So basically, just so you know that there's several options, and I'm just choosing the easiest option. My make there my Apache cd my Apache, and note that I prefix my modules with my because I don't want to override any existing modules. So I want to make sure that the stuff is unique, and I also name my modules in a consistent way that basically show you that what the module extends. So there's an existing module called guest, and this module, my guest, extends the existing guest module. And same for Apache. So there's an Apache module, and the my Apache module aims to basically extend that. So nano my Apache TE policy module, my Apache version 1.0.0, and then just optional policy again, so that it doesn't depend on anything that we use in here. Gen require, and let's import some stuff. So we want to import an attribute, and the attribute is in my buffer, MCS read all. So that basically says, okay, allow any type that has this associated to read all MCS, and then type HTTPDT. And that's just a quick solution, but whether that's the optimal solution is up to you. I'm not going to get into all that stuff. And then assign a type attribute, HTTPDT. If you really want to know the ins and outs, then you should just study this stuff in depth. Then you'll be able to make your own security decisions. I'm just guiding you, giving you some hints to get you started, because if I would have to teach you everything, then I would take me years, I guess. Not years, but a long time. Make F user share with Linux devel make file my Apache PD, and then as a module I my Apache PP. And this should probably get rid of this constraint violation. If my hunch is correct, although I have to say that there are some questions remaining for me. Let's try this again, and now it works. So that was it. Basically, somehow Apache was MCS constrained, at least to some degree. So now Apache can read content regardless of the categories associated to that content. So let's just do that for Jane as well. Make the public HTML CD public HTML, and then a nano index HTML, and then HTML header 1 hello world, and then close header 1, and then close HTML. And then basically cd back in there, restore con rv public HTML. And it's reset, and it's all Z. It's reset. CD, actually not CD. Let's go back to root and take care of other stuff. LS of CD home. LS all Z. Oh, I already took care of that. So now Jane should be taken care of as well. So let's just have verify that. And that's taken care of as well. So now we have that set up. So now basically you need to take care. So now you have compartmentalization, at least to some extent, in this extent that they can't see each other's processes, but they can actually see each other's home directories, which sucks. I'm not sure why that is, but there are ways to fix that using SELinux. You can just basically deny users to list user home routes in the first place, so that they can actually list the home root at all. They can traverse it, but they can't look into it. But that's more obscurity, I guess. That's not real security. But anyways, even if Joe would allow others, so let's just try that out. Let's say Joe is an asshole. Joe is an asshole, and Joe just says, okay, let's allow everyone. Gmod. Others plus read write x, and then home Joe. Now lslc home shows that Joe has been an asshole and just said everyone to read write. So now Jane should in theory be able to have full access to that stuff. So cd home, because Jane has the same type as Joe, it's both guest D, but they only have different categories. So now cd Joe permission is denied, and this is MCS kicking in, because they both have, from a type of enforcement perspective, Joe and Jane have the same security properties, except that we implement multi-category security for compartmentalization. So, and we have assigned different compartments to the different user home directories. So, since Jane is associated to the compartment C2, and the Joe home directory is associated to C1, Jane will not be able to access it, even though Joe allowed full access. Because Joe is stupid. So there's that mandatory compartmentalization kicking in there. So all in all, he can see the directories, but he can't actually use it. So if you could actually now basically just deny access to for users to actually read the home root, so that users can't actually see what's in here. They can traverse their home directories, but they can't see what's in there. And then to basically use MCS to restrain access, so that they even if they guessed that there would be a Joe home directory in there, that they can't actually traverse there anyways, because MCS will deny that access. So yeah, there's a lot of possibilities in there. And that's set back to normal. So now we have integrity, compartmentalization. As for availability, now I'm not going to go into that too deep, because I'm not that familiar with it either. But anyways, there's a package and it's installed. Policy Core Utils Python installed it. It's called libcgroup. RPM query list libcgroup. And there's probably other packages as well with regard to libcgroup. Basically, what it installs is some utilities for cgroup usage. It installs two daemons, the cgconfig daemon and the cgrulesd daemon. Now, basically, what you can do is you can use the cgconfig config file to create quote unquote groups and with different resource properties. I can look in it, and this might be an example or not, I'm not sure. Less etc. Actually copy that. So now there is none of it, but you could create a group, for example, or a user there with a name, and then use cd rules, which is the cd rules conf file, to associate that group, that cd config group, to or user to a actual Linux user. Just basically the same ideas as Linux, IBAC, identity based access control, that's used to associate SELinux to traditional Linux security. So this file is used, so here you can basically associate a group or a user identity to controllers, so you can control, in this case, the CPU is controlled, and then you have that for the user group, for the user group in this case, and then here's some other examples. But I'm not going to go into this, but then you can basically, when the user logs in, he gets a set of resource rules. So he can basically say, okay, users with this group can only use 10% of CPU usage, or can only send files with 100K a second. And stuff like that. You can do a network throughput, you can use disk throughput, you can use memory usages, you can use CPU usages, and you can use that to basically make sure that users can't actually bring the server to its knees. But of course, these are basically the three recommendations that I would give, but just plenty other stuff that you should implement as a security guy, because these are just some aspects. You should also use the default stuff like what's it called, lsetc, cgconfig, oh no, security, I'm sorry, security, what is it, limitsconf. You should also use limitsconf, and you should also use accessconf for IP security. I would use that, and then probably PAM time to access to only allow certain times login. Here is PAM time. And ASCII permit, you should also set ASCII permit, and I'll just show you that as well. Nano ASCII permit conf, because what you have is you depend on SELinux now a lot. So what you want to do is basically do the following. You should add guest underscore u here. And this basically tells PAM ASCII permit that users can only log in if SELinux is enforcing. So if for some reason SELinux is in permissive mode, then users are not able to log in. Let's see if that works. So we have Joe, let's log out Joe. And let's log him in to show you that it works. We're in enforcing, so we can log in. Let's go back, and now let's do set enforce 0. And go back to Joe and try and log in. Permission denied. Permission denied. So that's just a fail safe, just to make sure that users won't be able to log in when SELinux is in permissive mode. You want that because you're really depending heavily on SELinux, so you don't want users to be able to log in permissive mode, because then all those restrictions will be not be in place. So then the users will be able to do ugly shit. So this just scratches the surface, but this is basically a nice setup. If you use this and you use quota, disk quotas, and you use cgroup for resource management, and you use MCS for compartmentalization, you use type enforcement for integrity, then yeah, you can do really, really nice stuff. But again, use everything available to you. So also use the other PAM stuff, like PAM access, PAM time, PAM limits. Use any other security that you have to your disposal. Disable anything that you don't need. make sure you know how to audit your system as well. So Red Hat basically has a nice daemon called Audit. It should be somewhere in here. It's probably installed by default. Oh, actually, now I'm not on the server. I'll be damned. What the hell? It's here. PS aux. Audit D, which is basically Linux audit. And this can basically be used to for very fine-grained auditing. So you should set that up. And I do have some configurations. And there are also actually RPM query list audit. There should be, and there aren't. Oh yeah, here you have in the user share directory, you have some default, some rules that you can basically use in your audit rules file to set up some default rules that you might want to use. So for example, you have cap rules. Let's have a look at those. That's for auditing, because auditing is just a important part of security. So you have a lot of rules. For example, when people change ownership, it's getting logged. When stuff gets removed and linked, it gets logged. When extended attributes are changed, I guess, or set. So you can basically specify what is logged, and there are different of those example files. When the time changes, you get a log. When cron is changed, I guess. When the user databases is changed, you get a log. And then you should use the audit utilities to actually daily check out what's going on in the system. You want to actually, security is really mcsuntrustedproc. It's really a job, full-time job, so to speak, especially in large networks. So use those things and then you'll get a pretty neat system. So I guess I'll leave it at this. And just if you want to learn more about cgroups, I suggest you look into the kernel 3. There's some cgroup documentation in there, but Red Hat also has some nice documentation with regard to configuring cgroups. But it's still a technology that's changing, actually, in the current kernel. They're making changes to cgroup to simplify it quite a bit. So I wouldn't look too much at libcgroup to libcgroup, because that's probably going to be removed in Red Hat Enterprise Linux 7 and replaced by systemd and another implementation of cgroups. Actually, I'm not sure, but that might happen. So yeah, that's it.